praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hi, family. I'm glad to bring God's word to you in your home this wonderful Sunday morning. Great times we are in. Great opportunity to convey God's truth to our loved ones and believers alike around the world through the social media platform. And I thank God for the opportunity. Though our hearts still desire to meet as we should according to scripture, and not neglect the assembly of one another. But there is something in my spirit at a season like this that the Lord has dropped, which I believe will be beneficial and be a blessing to everyone that listens and be a part of what we're doing. Invite someone. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We appreciate the privilege and this honor that, Lord, we have in the name of the Lord Jesus to convey your words. The Bible says the entrance of your word, it gives light and it gives understanding even to the simple, even to the naive ones. And Lord, we count on your mercies and your faithfulness, Father, in conveying your truth, that this truth will birth and produce the real reason you ever unveiled it to us. Lord, we count on your faithfulness. Amen. And we say, Father, grant all trans here now precision in delivering your truth and make easy for understanding, even as we give ourselves to your truth, even your word, in Jesus' precious name.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
In the midst of what is going on around us in the whole world, it's important that we keep reminding ourselves as the Lord prompts issues and matters that we need to look into to us, so that we can keep ourselves in that place of protection and divine covering that God has always put us in and intended us to remain in. And so we'll be looking at one important thing today. It looks basic, but it has to deal with your or our identity, my identity as a child of God. Someone will wonder, what does my identity as a child of a king has to do with a crisis around the world? It's always had everything to do, as we will find out in God's word. And we will also be able to establish two core important things amongst many we will pick up today. And let me start here before we look into scripture. I don't know if you've ever found yourself in that place when growing up as a little child, and the wonders in the mind of a child, the wonder years they call it, when curiosity and questions start popping up, questions as we learn about creation and how the earth and we came to be, and we listened and dabbled in school and on cartoons at the time, and TV and on evolution, and at the same time we did dabble even in faith. And then I wasn't born again. I wasn't really from what you call a practicing Christian family. Yes, I had Christian background to the minimum, if that's what even counting. And one of the things that I discovered was there was always a wonder amongst many truths that were flung around or thrown at me as a child, was the devil. Realizing that the devil was on earth. And why did God ever put or create man with the very notion of following him, in regardless of the fact that Satan, the devil, was still on the earth or was on the earth already? Why didn't God get rid of the devil? Why did God allow the devil still in the scene to actually tempt man? And that may have come to you, and that may have come to you like it came to me. Why this evil? Now, I'll try to use that as a yardstick to give us an understanding on what is in the mind of God, in regardless of the perils And in regardless of the perilous times we find ourselves, in regardless of epidemic outbreaks and all the kinds of evil that we as humans and as children of light, children of God, Christians, will have to deal with daily. And if we can understand it properly and bring in perspective what has always been, you know, the Bible says that there is nothing new under the sun. Whatever is has always been and will always be. Oh, and that's the truth. So we need to understand how to deal with this. And going on with what I was saying, I began to appreciate when I discovered certain truth that amongst many things, Satan was never an issue. Satan was never an issue. The fact that Satan was in the earth, on the earth, doing what he was able to do was never an issue. Satan is an embodiment of evil himself, and that he was on earth was never going to be an issue. It's not an issue. It's never been an issue. Evil is not an issue. It's never going to be an issue. As long as we, as children of God, are mindful of who we are. The Bible says, as a man thinks or thinketh, depending on your translation, in his heart, so is he. So your ability to know who you are and think in line with it has so much to do with the victory that we walk in. You will see that in a bit. Now, talking about Satan while on earth, let's look at Genesis and we'll pull something from here and know how we can be mindful and use it in these seasons so you understand where I'm going at. I know I'm looking bogus. Look at Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter number 3, we'll read from verse 1. I think it will be a good place to start. Let me read the New King James. I have the New King James on the screen here, and any other translation like the New King James here. Okay, it says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, had God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. Verse 2, and the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Okay, it goes on verse 4, and the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die, for God does know that in the day ye or you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, or as God, all right, depending on your translation, knowing good and evil, knowing good and evil. That's verse 5, okay, verse 5, knowing good and evil. Now, some translations say you'll be like God. So we'll go on. Verse 6 says, and the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise. She took the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also to her husband with her, and he did eat. And verse 7, and the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig trees together and made themselves aprons or some form of covering. The Bible says in verse 8, and they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord amongst the tree of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said to him, where art thou? Verse 10, and he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. Now, note the word, verse 10. And he said, I heard thy or your voice in the garden. And what was the outcome? And I was afraid. Fear has come in for the first time. He said, because I was naked and I hid myself. Because I was naked and I hid myself. I think we will stop there for now. Now, if you read what we just read, as you heard, the Bible was so clear that when God created man, God actually gave him instructions. We didn't read in that bit, but Eve did explain it, or the woman. She said, God has told us when Satan was like, well, you know, eating of this. Come on, don't you think it's good you eat of this also? And Eve was like, yeah, well, we can eat everything except this fruit. And if you read Bible, it's called the fruit of good and evil. We can eat anything, but not just this one. And said, well, you mean that? He said, listen, eat of it. He said, no, God said the day we will partake or eat of it, we shall surely die. And no. And you won't really die. You won't really die. Ignore that. Well, what do you mean we won't die? He said, listen, the day Satan said, the day you eat of it, it will make you like God. And the woman was like, wow. She looked and saw, that seems true. We need to be like God. Now, note the point of contention was the identity. Who were they like? So the first question was, who were they like before now? Who were they like before now? So he was actually contesting and bringing some doubt into the mind of humanity, into the mind of the woman, concerning who she was like. Who was she? What was she originally? Let's look at what God had to say about them. Genesis chapter 1. In Genesis chapter 1, verse number 26, okay, these are the point of creation. It says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, or to be like us, okay, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the floor of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Verse 27 says, so God created man in his own image. Whose image? The image of God. In the image of God created him. Created he him. What does it go next? Male and female. So it was both Adam and his wife. She was included. It wasn't just Adam that was created first in the image of God, then the woman was brought out. No, it is the point of creation. God created Adam first. Then when God chose to create again out of Adam a woman, he brought a woman who was the same image as of Adam, which is the image of God. He said, created he them. So they were already in the image, mind you. They were already in the likeness of God. They already had the identity, as it were, of God. They were like God. They were gods, if you want to put it that way. That was what God created them to be. They were meant to function and to act like God. Someone once said to me, I've not seen it yet, but a translation said, let's create spirit-speaking beings like us. So they were in the image of God. They were operating like the Father. They had everything that it would take them to function on the earth in line with their status and responsibility on the earth, as far as God was concerned. They had nothing missing. They had nothing broken. But you see, Satan came into the scene to do just one thing, to actually clash with that paradigm of truth. He tried to bring them to the place where they doubted the authenticity of what God had done and what God has promised, or what God has said. They had come to a point where Satan could actually deceive them by actually bringing them to doubt what God has said concerning who they were. And this is where we find ourselves. Now, Satan was not an issue. In other words, Satan could be Satan for all he was on the earth, and the children of God, Adam and Eve, the product of God on the earth, they could still be walking who they were, living fine, and Satan was never an issue. But he knew that the way to rob them of their peace and security, of who they were, or of what God has going for them, was actually to bring them to the point where they become doubtful of who God has said they were, where they lose the sense of who they were, the sense of identity, of what God has made them to be, of who God has said they were, of who God had created them as. And that's the point we're talking about. Satan wasn't a big deal. Now, evil is never a big deal. People of God, evil, whether it be corona, whether it be cancer, whether it be AIDS or any of these diseases which are all around the world today. Now, are they real? Yes. Can they hurt man? Yes. But you see, in regardless of their potency to bring harm, to bring sudden death, to bring calamity to them, you see, like Eve was saying, he said, the day we eat of it, we will surely die. Now, it is true, but Satan was trying to bring them to the point where their identity is actually contested for. And when he succeeded, eventually they were exposed. What were they exposed to their vulnerability? I will explain a bit further. If you look at chapter 3, so it doesn't look like I'm putting a smoke shield over our eyes. In Genesis chapter 3, okay, verse number 22, you find an interesting read, which I need you to see. So you don't, oh, I didn't know this. You need to see it in life. It says, and God said, this is after they had eaten, they now are afraid, they are now discovered they are naked. You see that? They're now beginning to see their vulnerability. The vulnerability had always been there, but they did not see it. I don't know if you're getting me. Let me read it. Verse 22 says, and the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us. In what way? To know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Now you need to understand what's being played out here. Now, man has come to the point of vulnerability. Man had always been naked. Don't get me wrong. There was no clothing on him. But there was something of God's glory that was clothed on him of some form. In so much so that there was not an awareness of his vulnerability. The fact that he was naked. The fact that harm could come his way. He had no fear of anything. But the moment he did what he did, and this is the 2 points. Number one, he lost sight of his identity. He had no sense of his identity, who God has made him. Number two, that's why I said 2 points. Number two, what also played on was actually he broke fellowship of obedience with God. When those two things come out of place, you become vulnerable, you become empty, you become fearful, you become a target of everything. All until then, nothing has happened. The moment man ate and disobeyed God, and suddenly two things played out. The moment he doubted his identity, and as a result of that, he disobeyed God and fell into the act of sin or out of fellowship with the Father. What happened next? He became vulnerable. How? You could see fear came in. Fear came in. Now, and it, where we read next, the Bible was saying, God said, they are not like us. What was the issue here? Now, before now, God was aware of their vulnerability. God was aware of what was good and what was wrong. But now man has come to the point, and that was the only thing God doesn't want us to be engaged in as a child of God, where your mind is now consumed by your vulnerability. The moment a man loses sight of who he is in Christ, what God has done for him as his child, and a man has broken fellowship with God, suddenly this often is what will happen. You will become vulnerable. It is not a matter of the evil that is in the world. It's not a matter of Satan that is in the world. He had always been on the earth. Evil had always walked and roamed about. The Bible speaks of him as roaming to and fro the earth. He's always roaming around. The Bible tells us in the book of Job, God was asking him, how's it? You've been roaming all through the earth. You know, he's always roaming about like a vagabond. Now, he's always been around. But it was never an issue until man himself lost his identity. He became consumed with deceit. The Bible said the woman was deceived. She was deceived on knowing who she was. She was already like God. The only thing that was not made available to her was the knowledge of her vulnerability. Her vulnerability wasn't made available. It was not shown her. It wasn't that it did not exist. As long as she was in relationship with God and was consumed with who she was and who man was, the issue of the vulnerability was no longer relevant because it would have no impact on their well-being. As long as your vulnerability becomes apparent before your eyes, you become a losing fighter. You find boxers go through the ring. And when they go to the ring, there is some element of fear. But when there is more of a belief than the fear of the loss, they are often in the place of advantage. When athletes go for competition, the same thing. But no athlete goes for a competition and comes out victorious because they often use this word, he does not have the champion's mindset. You know, when he comes victorious, I said, I'm not taking no for an answer. I refuse to believe that I could lose this. I believe I could beat him. So they go into that approach. And that is the mindset God always wanted us. So he always fed us with the original. I don't know if I'm making sense. Let me put it this way. It's just coming. Years ago, it was said, I read something up, that somebody was put in a room. And what he was put in the room to do was count genuine dollar bills with his finger. He counted, I'm not too sure now, of how much time he was locked up there. His job was to feel and count the genuine dollar bill. Then after a while, they put a fake dollar bill in the midst. And when he went counting it, the moment his fingers came across a fake dollar bill, he stopped and said, I felt something not right. He went back and was able to pull out the fake counterfeit dollar bill. Now, why was that? Because he had been consumed with the real. Now, when we become consumed with the real deal, the real identity of who God says we are, then we become empowered to overcome what the enemy has to put at us. So I do not want to believe Satan hasn't tried other things before now that didn't work. But the moment the identity of man was successfully challenged, then man became vulnerable. Man then broke fellowship with God. Man now became a casualty and became a casualty to the trickery of the devil. Now, that is my point. Why, if you're catching what I'm saying, now, we're not saying coronavirus is not true. We are not even disputing the fact that sicknesses and disease, and even the coronavirus, doesn't have the potency to kill an individual. But what I'm trying to push to us, as God will help me through his word, is boost in you your immune system. What is that? An awareness of who you are as a child of God. Amen. That will bring about understanding and faith. I mentioned the Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. You become mindful and consumed who you think you are, and you become it. It is a principle of how things operate on the earth. The moment Eve was successfully deceived that she was not yet like God, she was not yet in the likeness of God until she ate of the fruit, she found herself doing that, being less of who she was. And when you and I, child of God, become paranoid with the reality of what God has said, become obsessed and say, listen, this is what the Bible says I am. I'm a child of light, and begin to think in the line of God's provision to provide, to protect, to deliver you because of who you are. The more you stand in an advantageous position over the devil, just like God had never seen the devil as a problem. And even he wasn't a problem, even while Adam was still and his wife in the mindset of who they were. They were awesomely created by God. These were people. The Bible says God brought the animal to Adam. He said, name them. And Adam will call them by name. They became what Adam called them. I don't know if you're getting me. If you read from the Bible, you find that down history, on time, men were being named according to their trade, their habits, who they were, their conditioning on earth. You call a man a blacksmith because he was a blacksmith. You give a man a name, you find that the interpretation of his name seemed to, in Bible days, go along with how their life evolved. So you find that the idea of Adam naming him, he looks at a goat and looks, say, I call you that. Now, I'm not saying he spoke English, but whatever he called the animal would take its form, his mentality, and that was a creative ability that was of God, that man possesses. And Adam began to operate like God. So him and Eve were like God until the identity of who they were was disputed successfully and they gave in. The same thing goes. Coronavirus is an evil on the earth. Cancer and any kind of sickness, they do exist. They have the ability to actually kill humans. We're not denying the scientific perspective. But the truth is what we come by. That when we become mindful of who we are, which is our identity, and secondly, you have not broken fellowship with the Father, you will be in a place where you will beat any form of device of the enemy. Every form of evil, every form of sickness, every form of defeat and disease that could be thrown at us, even if it jumps on your body, it should not last. Hallelujah. Amen. It should not last. How will it not last? Because of your mental strength of who you believe that you are. Someone was telling me a few days ago, was it 2 days ago? And he mentioned to me, saying a doctor, PhD, medical practitioner, and he actually said that fear has an ability of breaking down the immune system of a man. That has been proven. He told me, I don't know where he got it from. Probably that is what science has found out. And it's not a surprise to me if that is really the case. Because actually, a man whose mind is full of who he is, and he is strong in his will as of what God has said concerning him, in the face of evil, he will prevail. But a man who doubts who he is, hence the Bible speaks about Abraham that hoped against hope and staggered not in unbelief. Hallelujah. Regarding the promise that God has for him as a child, it only took time, but it did happen. It's the same approach where we hope against hope and stand in the place where we stagger not at what we'll look at in 1 minute now, of what God and who God has declared that you and I, child of God, who we are in him. Hallelujah. Amen. So let's look at some of the truth that God has said. Look at the book of the New Testament, 1 John or 1 John. 1 John chapter number 3. All right. I'll read from verse 1. 1 John chapter number 3. I'll read from verse 1. It's an interesting read in God's word. It says here, it said, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Hallelujah. Amen. I'll stop there. We're still in chapter 1. So here, John is saying, he said, behold. Now, don't just read, behold. No. He screamed out. Hallelujah. Amen. It was a shout of, behold. He's like trying to say, come on, take hold of this truth. Hallelujah. Amen. He said, can't you see it? Amen. Amen. He said, look and see for yourself the manner of love. In other words, this is love. Hallelujah. Amen. This has to be love. Why? He said, this is love. This is love. What is the love all about? He said that he has bestowed upon us. Hallelujah. Amen. In other words, he's thrown it upon us. The Bible says elsewhere that we used to be enemies. Okay? From the time of sin and the sin nature that man got, yeah, we became enemies of God. But when we give our life, when you give your life, and when you make Jesus the Lord of your life. The Bible is saying, whoa, come on, servant of God, look, child of God, behold, behold, please see it. That was scripture. Can you not just see it? See the love that the Father has put upon me. Hallelujah. Praise see God. The love the Father has thrown upon you.
Hallelujah.
That you be called the sons of God. Depending on your translation, I believe one says children of God or child of God. You see, what manner of God has bestowed that we be called the children of God. We become sons of God. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Mind you, it means that you have become like God. When Jesus said that he was the son, now we are not the son, we're sons. But when he said he was the son, they almost stoned him. In the Gospels, the Bible says, for the Jews said, he made himself equal with God. So it is an identity of the personality of who God is, that God has poured and bestowed and placed upon you. That you are not just ordinary. Hallelujah. Amen. It says that you be called the sons of. It says, behold, what manner of love? But it goes on and says, therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. In other words, if this is the case, then the world doesn't know us. Hallelujah. Let me use the New King James, if it will help a bit to throw light. You could use other translations, and it will do the same beautiful thing to you. John, 1 John chapter number 3, verse, hallelujah. Chapter number 3. Chapter number 3. Blessed be Jesus.
Amen.
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 Okay? Chapter number 3. All right. I'll read it. It says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called children of God. In the New King James Version, there's an hyphen. In other words, like he's shouting out. Okay? He said, therefore, the world doesn't know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, or now we are sons of God. It goes on. He says, it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Now, the issue is this. In physical terms, I'm not different from anyone in the street. I'm not different physically, humanly speaking, physically talking about it, from any man on the street. Anyone, what makes you different? That's what they will ask you. What makes you think you're different from anyone who contacts a person with this virus? What makes you different from anyone who is in contact, or who someone with a sickness comes across that is contagious? What makes you different? Because you physically, there's nothing. Humanly speaking, biologically speaking, the Bible says it doesn't appear. We're not looking any different. It said, but however, our difference in appearance will come about in one day when Jesus will physically appear. However, even in this present time, behold, he's not saying wait for them. He's saying see it now.
Amen.
It has happened.
Hallelujah.
That we are now identified with Christ. We carry on us his identity. Amen.
Amen.
Just as he is, the Bible will say, just as he is now, so are we in this world. In other words, my challenge to you, child of God, is would corona actually affect Jesus as he is right now? The answer is no. If it wouldn't, so it has no power over you.
Amen.
It is your identity.
Mm-hmm.
It is your identity. Please be mindful of it.
Amen.
I may not feel different, but that is it. Hallelujah. I am different. Why? Because of the love that has been thrown on me.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't do anything to deserve it. Out of love and mercy, God has done it for me.
Amen.
Amen. Behold. So the Bible is saying this is what God has done by reason of what Jesus has done. But let's go on to something more interesting. Hebrews chapter 5. Or Hebrews chapter 2 rather, from verse 5. Hebrews chapter 2. Okay, I'll read from verse 5. Oh, blessed be Jesus. Okay, it says, for unto the angels had he not put in subjection the world to come. therefore we speak. But one in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him, or visitest him? Verse 7, thou madest him a little lower than the angels, thou crownest him with glory and honor, and didst set him over the works of your hands. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing, hallelujah, nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should test death for everyone. So we see Jesus, we saw what he went through, that he went through just so that you wouldn't have to eventually go through some of all those things, or in fact, every of such things. Hebrews chapter 2. I'll read from the New King James. I want to believe it will help us. Hebrews, blessed be Jesus. Hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. Chapter number 2. Okay. We'll read from verse 5. Blessed be Jesus.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Okay. This is where we go. It says here, I'm trying to pick different translations, but let's stick to what we, New King James. It says here, it says, for he has not put the world to come, of which we speak, in subjection to angels, but one testify in a certain place, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you should take care of him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. You have crowned him with glory and honor, and set him over the works of your hands. You have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God might test death for everyone. Blessed be Jesus. Amen. I'm so glad. So here again we see it. The Bible says here, the writer of Hebrews say, was speaking and was quoting something relevant, scriptural, that lines up even with something said in the Old Testament. Who is man? Who is humans? Who are humans? Who is man that you are mindful of him? A mere man that, Father, you decide to visit him. He said that when you did, you did something, God. You chose not to bring everything under him, in subjection to him. You left nothing, nothing. Now, this in its, what we've just read, speaks of a plan of God in the future. However, child of God, it is still your identity and who you are now. The plan of God is this, and that's what it was saying. I like it. He said there is nothing that is not yet brought in subjection to man. Everything has been brought under the authority and the governorship of humans. Now, but it doesn't appear so. Why? He said, we see Jesus. And Jesus did what he did, went through the cross, died the death he died. And you find that not all humans will ever experience the beauty of this truth, except those that accept him as Lord. And accept, this is where I'm talking about. That two things, I said it earlier on. One, identity. Second thing is your fellowship with God. My fellowship and the fellowship humans have with God has been actually mended and repaired through the blood and the sacrifice of Jesus. If you have that, if you made Jesus the Lord of your life, you have fellowship intact. If you're walking out based on his word, if you're not living a compromising life, and you discipline yourself, Yes, we know there are all sorts of things that tries to lure us, is either to damage our relationship with God or to contest our identity in Christ. It's always those two things, if not even the two at the same time. Either one of the two or the two. So you find today where we live, you find children of God who are born again, who are, have a good relationship with God, but there's a problem with the identity crisis. They don't know who they are. They are not nurtured on who they are. They are not trained. They are not taught. They are not discipled to understand now you're in Christ, this is who you are. You've now become the seed, the child of the King. The Bible says that the seed of God dwells in you. He that is born of God overcomes the world. You don't know who you are. Now, it is not talking it I'm talking about. Because I've also seen believers, they talk it big. The moment crisis comes, everything falls apart. And it baffles me always. Because I've heard brothers, I've heard sisters, they talk faith, they preach faith. But the moment a crisis shows up, or something seems to be stubbornly, consistently at work against them, for a short time, they crumble. But we need to be more resilient.
Amen.
The Bible speaks of it, of the life of Job. Job was resilient, and in the end, he came out victorious.
Amen.
All right? The same story, the Bible says, as soldiers, Paul was speaking to Timothy, we need to endure hardship. There are sometimes you become resilient against the opposition of the enemy. It is always to come to fight your identity or to break your fellowship with God. Where you have slept away, many a times we do, make amends. Return to God. Make amends. Confess your sin. Tell the Lord, listen, I missed it. This is my wrong. Have mercy on me. And return back to God. Say, but I don't care how many times. The Bible says the righteous will fall 7 times. He will rise again. There's something about the righteous. He doesn't stay down in sin. He makes amends as quickly as possible with a desire and an intent not to fall back to it. But if he were, he rises up. That's the beauty of the righteous. But then this goes on, that again, your identity. Two things. And as I'm focusing today, I want you to know that salvation is meant for everyone who accepts the Lord Jesus did. And as it becomes your portion, also your personality, your identity, who you are in this kingdom, it changes altogether.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says the world doesn't know who we are.
Mm-hmm.
Because physically speaking, biologically speaking, we've not changed. Nothing has changed. It's the same flesh and bones and blood that is in us. The same organs and hair and teeth and everything. But spiritually, there's a shift.
Amen.
And it is upon this we stand different. When Adam was in his place of a mindfulness, him and his wife, they knew who they were. They were consistent, feeding themselves. They knew who they were. They were going about doing what God required of them in keeping the garden, in naming animals, in their place of authority, of dominion, in their mindfulness of who they were. They did not feel defeat. But the moment they gave in to a second opinion of if they are, what they need to do extra to become. And this is where we make mistakes. I'm not against washing of hands. I'm not against, sure, wash your hand normally. Okay, personal hygiene. Or using all sorts of things you need. I'm not against it. But do not get yourself locked up in a lie of the devil. Do not, child of God. I remember ordering a product yesterday also, from one of these high-end shops online that sells, and it was just a basic device. And as I opened it and everything, later something came to my mind. What came to my mind? An information that would have never come to my mind until somebody pushed it to me and said, oh, what you need to do, send it to me on my WhatsApp. And I watched it for a bit. Oh, when you get any product that is sent to you by post, do not touch it for 24 hours. Then you go, then you now touch it. You get where we're going to? Why don't you touch it for 24 hours? And truly, child of God, you are keeping it for, you say, no, they say 24, I'll keep it for 48, so that this virus must die. Then you go on and you're busy wiping it. you know, wiping. I was watching TV last night, and a woman who ordered the product online got full stop, and she was outside wiping it. And I just watched a clip where she said, "I take my time to wipe everything, bread, wipe it." Well, and she was wiping everything. And you are a child of God, you're doing the same thing. Something is wrong. What is wrong? The problem is you're giving yourself to the whisper of the serpent. The Bible calls him the old serpent. Don't give in.
Amen.
You are bigger than it. You can beat it. Praise God. You don't put yourself in harm's way. But you're not stupid when you find yourself in a situation where you become paranoid. Why? Because of who you are. This is who you are. All things are subject to you. You know what? The Bible says that Adam named the animals. They became it. So you, at the same time, can be faced with coronavirus and give it a name. You change its name, it will change form. Hallelujah. Take that in your mind. Because of who you are. You say, that person had coronavirus. No, he had malaria. You give it a different name. And you'll be shocked. They'll say, we thought it was, but it was actually malaria. But how did he get malaria? In this part of the world, there's no mosquito. This is a strange one. Yes, because a child of God named coronavirus malaria bacteria, it suddenly changed form. You have the capacity and ability. Be mindful of who you are. So a child of God comes and they say, this is what you have. He comes and he changes the name. Hallelujah. It's who you are. You have that potency, that ability. Listen, if I hold a microphone in my hands, this is how potent God is. And God and Jesus shows up and tells me what you're holding is a speaker. I said, no, it's a microphone. That microphone will change form and become a speaker because that is what God had declared it to be. That's the same thing in your lips, in your life. That's the same format and anointing. That's the same calling. That's the same identity you have. An ability to make a thing work. If you know this is what you carry, just for an instance, why will you be so frightened?
Hallelujah.
You meet a person and the person is coughing and saying, you're working as a nurse, and it's, that person has been diagnosed. You say, no, I think they should check it again. You say, why do you say so? You say, because I saw that isn't it. That was just an, no. And later they come and say, it was a cold. I don't know what was wrong with the kit. It is possible. Hallelujah.
Praise.
I know a plumber, they came and they checked. I remember my wife. We were giving birth to our first child, and they checked her blood pressure, and they said, it is high. And I and her were there in the delivery suit, and we said, no, the machine is broken. And the nurse looked at us, or the midwife. She said, we said, I think you should check, bring another one. This one is broken. So they took it off her, and they brought another one, and they checked, and said, it's normal. Why? Listen, I don't think it was broken. We said it was broken. It became broken. And another had to bring the report we expected. That is the same spirit you carry. Don't become a wimp. Your identity in Christ says you are like God. Hallelujah. The Bible says, I have said ye are gods. And ye are sons of the Most High. But you will die like men. Why is it coming that way? No. Because if you don't accept your identity, anything will have you. Begin to speak it as you want it. The Bible says you will decree a thing, it will be established.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to encourage you. It is not just about corona. This is what we use and operate on earth as children of light. In every circumstance, name it and declare what it is. It is not just a name it, claim it. No. It is a name it because of who you are in the name of Jesus, and it becomes it. May I also encourage us, on Thursday, we will be live. I will be breaking bread in the name of Jesus. So I want you to get wine, anything basic you can lay your hands on, and bread, and we'll break communion together. Invite family Thursday, 7 p.m. by the grace of God. We'll be breaking bread, and we will see God release his power. We'll be dealing with something unique in this regard again. Father, we thank you. We ask that you bless the listener. Increase them in heart and in faith, that they may become children shining your light everywhere they go. Thank you for another morning. God bless you, servants and children of God, till we see again, in Jesus' precious name.
Amen.
Amen.